Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Cassidy Diamond. I am the Associate Director of Public Programs and Events here at the IDA. I am thrilled to have you all here for our kickoff event for this Spring's Award Spotlight series. You all are in for an amazing conversation, and I'm so glad you could be here with us. Before we begin, I would just like to offer a brief land acknowledgement. I'm coming to you today on the unceded land of the Tongva and Chumash people, currently known as Los Angeles. I'm up in the San Fernando Valley. We'd like to thank these people who have been stewards of this land for generations. I'd also like to give a shout out to our media sponsor, Variety. Without their support, we couldn't bring this series to you all, so thank you to them. And we have a bunch more programs coming up. If you go to documentary.org/award spotlight, and I'll give Gabe a chance to catch up. I know I just threw a lot at you, Gabe. You can check out the rest of our series. We have 17 more screenings and Q&As coming up, and I'm sure you're gonna love all of them. But you aren't here to see me. So I'm gonna hand this over to our amazing host, LaTosha Brown from Black Voters Matter. She's going to guide us on this conversation today. Welcome, LaTosha.
Greetings. I'm so happy to be here. I'm really excited about this discussion.
Me too. It's all yours.
Okay. Hi, greetings. I hope all is well. I am LaTosha, and She Could Be Next was directed by Grace Lee and Marjan Safinia. It tells a story of a defiant movement of women of color, transforming politics from the ground up. Now, this two-part series follows candidates and organizers all across the country, now asking whether democracy itself can be preserved or made stronger, but by those who are most marginalized. Now, although the film was shot in 2018, the themes for this film have never been more resonant. Now, you only need to turn on the news to see how white supremacy is manifesting all across our nation. Egregious acts of voter suppression, the attacks on voting rights, the rise in anti-Asian hate, and the ongoing threat around voting rights on HR 1, building power through Black and Asian solidarity, and the radical organizing of our communities led by women of color. And while we see some of these trends everywhere, we see all of them converging in Georgia. And that's why Georgia is on everybody's mind. Now, joining to get this discussion started is Marjan Safinia, or Marge, who is an Iranian documentary filmmaker whose films examine identity, community, and social justice. She currently serves on the board of directors of Chicken and Egg Productions and is a regular juror, programmer, speaker, and connector of all things documentary. Now, Grace Lee is an award-winning documentary director and producer. She received a Peabody Award for her film, American Revolutionary, The Evolution of Grace Lee Boggs, and recently produced two episodes of PBS five-part series, Asian Americans. Greetings, Marge and Grace.
Hi, LaTosha. It's lovely to see you.
It's wonderful to see you. How are you all doing? And I'm really super excited about this discussion. Can you tell us a little bit about what we are here for?
Yes. Well, first of all, thank you, LaTosha, for hosting us. So I just thought I would start out, Marge and I will just start out telling a little bit about the film so we can just get to the real meat of the discussion. And She Could Be Next, I guess most of you have watched it by now, really tells this story about a movement of women of color who are transforming American politics. And a little bit of the background on it, you know, the idea sort of first came in 2016 when we thought we might have our first woman president. But looking at the demographics and how America's population is, you know, rapidly becoming majority people of color, especially in many states across the country, including Georgia, we wanted to tell a story that really firmly stuck a stake in the ground that, you know, looking at race and gender when we come to American politics, you know, it's rare that you tell an epic political story that centers these two ideas amongst other things. And yeah, so I'm sure you all saw that, but Marge, do you wanna add to that?
Yeah, I just wanna talk about why Georgia. I found it really amusing watching the election coverage in 2020 and hearing folks like Wolf Blitzer talk about Georgia as the political epicenter of the universe. And I was thinking, hello, you're like 2-3 years late to the party, Wolf, right? Because we knew that Georgia was the political epicenter of the universe, you know, even prior to the 2018 elections when we were filming. So we were drawn initially to film in Georgia because Stacey Abrams's race that year was historic, and we were focusing on, you know, women of color in politics, and she was the first Black woman to ever be nominated for a gubernatorial candidacy. But then when we got to Georgia, we met these extraordinary organizers, and like good documentarians, we followed the story as it kind of was there in front of us, and we were so taken by the amazing kind of intersectional organizing that's happening there, that started way before we started filming and is continuing now, and some might say saved democracy for us in the year of our good Lord 2020. So being really interested in centering the voices of these women always, Grace and I thought, we don't really want to spend much of this time talking. We really want to pass the mic to our sisters in the fight, LaTosha, Ensei, and Stephanie. So we're going to take a step back, pass the mic, and let LaTosha continue the conversation about what's happening in Georgia.
Thank you, Grace and Marge, and you all do fabulous work, and your work is a part of the movement. So thank you for lifting our voices. I'm super excited to have this discussion with two women who I consider as comrades, who I consider as leaders, who are actually shaping not only the state of Georgia, but I think that they're shaping this nation going forward. And so I want to introduce to you Stephanie Cho, who's Executive Director of Asian Americans Advancing Justice in Atlanta. She brings over 20 years of experience in labor and community organizing. She's a strategist. She does strategic planning and fundraising at the local and national level. And then Ensei Ufot, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the New Georgia Project and its affiliate, the New Georgia Project Action Fund. Under Ensei's leadership, New Georgia Project has registered nearly 400,000 Georgians to vote. I'm so happy to have both of them today for this discussion. Greetings, Stephanie and Ensei. Hi.
Hi, sis. How you doing?
I'm good. My sister's in the struggle. I'm so happy to see both of you. I want to jump right in. I'm going to jump right in with you, Ensei. You know, as we're thinking about now where people are looking at, okay, we're past the election season. We're in 2021, right? 2020 is happening, 2018. You know, I want you to kind of give your perspective so people can get a feel on, you know, 2018 was a groundbreaking year. And when we're looking at what happened in 2020, but as you see what happened in these last 3 years, what do you think are the differences on the ground? What's changed on the ground, particularly in terms of voter access?
I think there are a couple of things. I mean, you know, there's a saying in our community that if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. Right. And so I think that there has been, I look at you and your leadership and your partner, Cliff, and how y'all run Black Voters Matter, and Stephanie, and Asian American Advancing Justice, that there's been rhetoric, right, around, you know, long-term strategy, long-term investment, long-term community organizing, that, you know, help us break out of the boom and bust that comes with electoral opportunities, that we work to connect elections and election outcomes to the long-term things that we want to win for our communities. And we've been saying it for a long time. And I think that the difference between for like a 2020 and a 2012 is that there are more people who are believing us, more people who are investing in us. But there's still a lot of work to get done. I think also people believe us now when we say that Georgia has been a battleground state, that it has been competitive, that it's just that it hasn't looked like what the you know, the DC insiders and the political elite have thought about. Like, if you're going to win in Georgia, you're going to have to find some Asian American leaders. You're going to have to find Black leaders in rural parts of the state who are not on your list, who are not in the cool kids clubs, if you want to be effective. If this is about low ego and high impact, you are going to have to do things differently. And I think that, you know, there's been a coming out party, if you will, of how leaderful Georgia is, that there's so many dope humans and particularly women and femmes that are doing this work. And we are America's new political onion. Just keep peeling back the layer.
That's right. You know, and also it's an issue of an investment. You know, what we know is in these areas, particularly in the South, because it hasn't been perceived as a battleground state, we've not seen the kind of investment on the ground. And so in this last couple of years, what we've seen is organizations be able to tap into, such as yours, to be able to tap into resources, to be able to get those resources on the ground. And do you think that's made a difference?
I do, but let me say a caveat. The lawyer in me, right? So yes, right? And you can see that with clear results in the November 2020 general and the January runoff. But then a few days later, we were in the legislature fighting Jim Crow 2.0, right? And so what people don't know is that it is a lot easier, I think, for us in this moment to win statewide because we have become more sophisticated with our voter protection, you know, apparatus, et cetera. And we can move a number of people to sort of overwhelm any of their voter suppression schemes on statewide. But because in Georgia, you want to talk about gerrymandering, in the Georgia legislature, they are allowed to redraw our districts every year. Not every 10 years, like what happens with congressional districts. They can redraw state legislative districts every single year. And you better believe that they take the opportunity to do so. And so it is a constant game of whack-a-mole when you think about how to protect what we have within the state and the control that we need, the power that we need within the state to win. So I will say we took some L's recently in the state legislature, at the same time where we are winning and doing huge things and making history on a state level and a federal level.
And so in terms of time and say, what's driving this aggressive push right now in this moment? You know, we're seeing this voter suppression. We're seeing this aggressive push to limit access to the ballot. Right. Help people to understand why. Why now?
I think it's two things I want to point out. One is that what we are witnessing right now is low-key a civil war between this version of the Republican Party, right? That you have your clout chasers, right? In addition to your pedophiles like Matt Gaetz, et cetera, who are already in preparing for a Trump 24 presidential run, right? And then you have the Never Trumpers, the Liz Cheneys, I would call them like traditional conservative Republicans. And they don't agree on anything except for making it more difficult for people to vote. That's it. That's the unifying issue. That's the number one issue that they're working on, that they're raising money for, that they're coordinating around. And so I think that that is why we're seeing it in this moment, because that's the only thing that they can agree on. The second thing is that it's the big lie. It's the continuation of the big lie, that it was the big lie that powered those 63 lawsuits that the Trump campaign filed in 63 courts across the country, and not one single court found evidence of widespread voter fraud. Not one, including several judges who were Trump appointees. The big lie powered those 63 lawsuits. The big lie powered the Capitol insurrection, where folks killed people. They murdered people in the United States Capitol, in the People's House. They carried the Confederate flag, something that Confederate soldiers weren't even able to accomplish during the Civil War. That was also powered by the big lie that there was widespread voter fraud and that Trump won. And it's these 361 bills. They're also powered by the big lie. Now, LaTosha, Stephanie, y'all know these jokers in the Georgia State Legislature. I'm not convinced, and y'all don't have to agree with me, but I'm not convinced that most of them can read. let alone write such sophisticated legislation, right? That it mirrors legislation that's been introduced in 46 additional states, right? That again, well-resourced, highly coordinated, that is designed to give legs to extend this fight to discredit the results of the 2020 election. And it's because what? Because they weren't able to suppress enough votes to determine the outcome, and they mad about it.
Right. So how do we fight back? Like, I know we have, what are our legal options, but even options beyond that, what is it that we can do to fight back?
I think that there's a lot. We have filed a number of lawsuits. I feel like Stephanie can talk about theirs. We are joint plaintiffs in the Georgia lawsuit. I know you all, 15 minutes after the law the bill became a law in Florida, Black Voters Matter filed challenging the anti-voting bills in Florida. So, I mean, I think that litigation is a powerful tool, but it also takes time. I think that too, there is, HR 1 and HR 4, which are two pieces of federal legislature that we are trying to get heard in Congress and voted on before the August recess, before the December recess at worst. And the idea is that instead of playing again whack-a-mole and trying to help out the homies in Texas and trying to help out the homies in West Virginia, trying to help out the homies in North Carolina and Florida, that we set a federal standard for elections. It's beyond time that there has been a floor, right? Every state should have at least 15 days of early voting. Now, if you want to, exceed best practices, that's fine. You can have 21 days, but there should be a floor for how elections are conducted in all of our states, right? So that's what we're pushing for. And then I think, folks, we are also fighting in the court of public opinion. Mm-hmm. So, between the full page ads that our coalition has taken out to the digital ads that are sort of helping cut through the noise and let people know what's happening in this moment, the sort of popular education, we have volunteers, we've sent millions of text messages and phone calls at this point, and that each of like Georgia's CEOs from publicly traded companies have gotten at least 10,000 emails, so much so that some of them have changed their email addresses. That's what I'm most proud of. But this corporate accountability campaign, listen, we have, and you won't brag on yourself, so I will, right? That in Georgia, under LaTosha and Cliff's leadership and Stephanie's leadership, we've low-key out-organized the Chamber of Commerce. We were 6 weeks into our corporate accountability campaign before the National Chamber of Commerce decided to come out with a position in opposition of HR 1, right? So like the kind of creativity, the creative leadership, not only showing up because we work with cultural workers, right? So there's art, right? And there's graphic design and all of that, like just telling better stories about what's happening in this moment so people understand and can make sense of the world that we're in right now. There's a lot. Listen, we believe in organization over here. I would encourage anyone under the sound of my voice that if this matters to you, we believe that the right to vote is preservative of all of the other rights that we fight for daily, that we care about. And so you might be a climate voter, right? Or a climate organizer. You might be a reproductive justice activist. But if the right to vote is threatened, if our ability to participate in our democracy is threatened, you better believe that all of our other rights will follow. And so find your political home, find your people, because this is a moment that is going to require us to find the folks who share our values so that we can work together to defend what we care about the most.
Absolutely. One of the things that you raised, and I'm so happy you raised this, you talked about the different organizations. I've lived in Georgia for, I think, 12 years. I've never seen the kind of aligned coalition building and working together that I've seen across the board, multiracial organizations, multi-generational organizations. You know, I want to lift that up, and I want to lift up your leadership and the leadership and the creativity of the New Georgia Project to actually stand in that space, to help hold space, you know, for us to all kind of work together. And so I don't know if there's some keys that you want to lift up in terms of some of that work, pulling that work up. But I think the larger question too is that everyday people who are watching this, right, what can they do to push back on voter suppression? What can the average person who really is concerned about what's happening right now, what could they do and what should they be doing?
Right. I think that one, we can make sure that you know what it looks like, right? That we can define it for people, right? That I know that, you know, folks often, when you hear voter suppression, they think about Bubba, you know, with his shotgun, trying to intimidate voters. And let's be clear, that exists. That is a thing. We have all had our lives threatened because of our election protection and voter work that's happening in the state. But that's not the only way, right? That, you know, for those of us who have had the occasion to change our names, right? That exact match, if you are African-American, you're 8 times more likely to be purged from Georgia's voter rolls. So getting into a regular habit, a regular cadence of checking to make sure that you haven't been purged and showing your people how to check, right, to see if they haven't been purged from the voter rolls. I think that that's an important thing that they can do. I think, too, that there's a lot of misinformation that is being put out about voting and how you can and cannot vote. And given the number of changes that Senate Bill 202 has made in Georgia, that we're talking about at least 50 different changes to rules and laws and like the actual way that Georgians are allowed to vote. So making sure that, you know, you are amplifying information from trusted messengers, I think is super important. You know, we used to be in this place where we would retweet and be like, you know, because somebody would say, you know, make sure you go vote on Wednesday, you know, November 5th, and the election was actually Tuesday, November 4th. And we would retweet and be like, look at this lying liar who lies. Don't do this, y'all. But we now know that the algorithm does not care about our analysis, right? That if we retweet it, if we repost it, that we are boosting it, we are amplifying it, right? So making sure that you're looking at the dates, that the information that you're sharing is from a trusted messenger. And again, that you are the person in the group chat that's like, hey, everybody, voter registration deadline is October 4th, right? That we have an active approach to participating in our elections, that folks know that, I know y'all are getting the questions now. Well, what are our plans for 2022? What is Warnock going to do? What is Stacey going to do? What is Keisha going to do? Right? And we're getting all of these questions, but there's 2021 and there are over 1,600 municipal elections in Georgia, mayors, right, City council, etc. So be the person, the accountability person, that this is something that we don't need superheroes. We don't elect messiahs, that this is going to take all of us, right, in order to protect our elections and to protect our democracy.
Well, I don't know about heroes, sheroes, and say, because I see that cape over there that you have. So I've seen your cape before. So thank you for all your work. I want to come to my sister, Stephanie. Stephanie, before you go on, I just want to say to you, like, you have been, your organization has been outstanding, that the work that you all did this last election cycle, that most people don't know, that the turnout in your community almost doubled. And so, and that was partly, I mean, primarily because of the leadership and the vision and the work that you're leading. And so I just want to say personally, publicly say thank you for all of the work that you lead day in and day out. You know, but as we, I want to come to you and ask you about this moment that we're in right now. As we have kind of experienced this horrific rise in anti-Asian violence all throughout the nation, including what we experienced here in Atlanta, the mass shooting at the Atlanta spa, which took the lives of 8 people, including 6 Asian Americans. You know, do you see a connection between the kind of language that some elected officials have used, or leaders have used, to describe why access to the ballot should be limited, and the rise in violence? Is there a connection? Do you see a parallel between those things?
I'm not
not sure that I do, because the rise in violence had been happening before that. And honestly, the rise and sort of anti-Asian backlash has been going on for quite a while. And in terms of people feeling more bold to say and to really put out misinformation about things, I think that has actually caused more issues within the community too, especially also with voting. In 2020, particularly around the runoff, there was so much misinformation that was happening in multiple different languages. And all of us had to really combat a lot of that. In addition to the pandemic, in addition to being blamed for the pandemic, right? East Asians in particular, China flu, all of that. In addition to the rise of, the anti-Asian violence. And then I think it does though correlate with the pandemic, and also the reason why so many Asian Americans in Georgia during the runoff voted absentee, right? That is a clear connection. We heard time and time again from especially first-time Asian voters, seniors, right? First time, they're like trying to figure out a way to do it, you know, remotely, if possible, because of the fear of being harassed, you know, at the very least, or something more violent happening to them just by voting at the polls. And we had a tremendous turnout, which is still a really positive sign. So when I think about the future of it, I am really hopeful, because despite all of this, right, the rise in the hate, the incident that happened in Atlanta, I mean, it just broke a lot of people, right? It broke, I mean, it was really hard on me personally. We're working a lot with the families directly. We set up a victims fund. And I think what we're seeing is also at the same time of a horrific thing happening, you see an outpouring of support that I don't think I've ever really seen. And at the same time, we get a massive amounts of hate mail in a way that we never did before. And you all know this. I mean, we have like a in-language voter hotline like every year. People can call in and ask questions in different languages. We got a lot of harassing calls during this year, more than we did in other years as well. And you all know too, if you're vocal, right, you're a woman of color, you get it, right? And that is definitely happening, you know, here with us as well. But I think, you know, when I look at sort of the overall picture in Georgia, I see that number one, people are noticing the Asian American community in a way that they didn't. That was part of the election, the general, but actually it went back to 2018 too, right? Mm-hmm. Our first campaign on our C4 side was Asians for Abrams. It was a solidarity campaign. And the reason why we even started the C4 was to build more political power for Asian Americans in the South.
Thank you, Stephanie. You know, racism isn't new to this country, nor is anti-Asian violence. And so I'm wondering, just as you said and you've experienced, while we know it's been here, there seems like there has been a rise, right? It is intensified. And I'm just wondering your thoughts around what is driving kind of this intensified hatred? What is driving this right now? What do you think?
It's a combination of, you know, sort of general patriarchy. It's a combination of sort of the fanning the flames and rhetoric of how Asians are connected to the coronavirus and the blame. Now we're moving into this whole situation where there are leaders in the Indian community and South Asian community that are really concerned that the backlash is actually gonna go towards them because of the rise of cases in India too. So we are, as Asian Americans, we're preparing for those things because the blame is sort of like intensified. And it's in this moment now when we're looking at also, you know, the shooting that happened as well, like with the FedEx individuals and the Sikh individuals, so many people are looking at why is the violence really sort of intensifying for Asian Americans, for the Amemza community overall. And it really is that blame, but it's also towards people at work, right? These are individuals that are in vulnerable situations where they are simply at work, they're standing on a corner of a street, they are going to the grocery store, everyday things. That's right. Those are when those attacks are happening. And it's so you know, sort of like intensified because I think pandemic life has also isolated people's information even more in a way where it's very hard for folks to get out of their bubble. And then, you know, the racist rhetoric is continuing, and you have these new networks that are coming on, and I just started watching them. Have you watched any of them yet? Mm-hmm. Own and all. So I was watching.
I love them.
So I started watching them because I need to understand it, right? Like I was like, I need to understand that way of thinking to sort of like be able to, you know, really correctly and thoughtfully combat it, right? So I think that there's that piece that is going to continue and intensify as things move on. And so like right now, I sort of see, you know, the history sort of moving through is that Asian Americans unfortunately have been blamed for diseases in the past.
That's right.
Sort of trope that's happening again, and it will continue to happen as long as white supremacy, you know, free.
Absolutely. But Stephanie, the, you know, on the flip side of that is we saw more Asian American young voters engage. Yeah. The good news is that there seems like there is an increase in engagement. What's driving that?
I think you have Asian Americans in Georgia are coming of age. And I keep saying that because it is the literal age, like more and more people are becoming eligible to vote. And secondly, we have more people that are naturalized. We have new people that are moving to Georgia. And then we also have people who have lived their whole lives in Georgia in the South and now feel like they have that voice. And they have that sort of security that they're not the only ones. And they're seeing that for the first time that they're actually not the only ones. And actually young people have been always the cornerstone of like moving things forward, particularly with Asian Americans. And so here in the South, I mean, you all employ a lot of young people, everybody does, you know, it's like they're, that's who's coming, you know what I mean? And
that's right.
That's where, you know, sort of the energy is moving. And so that whole place is really changing. And so they're not voting the same and really having these deep conversations with their family members.
Mm-hmm. And you know, something you said, I just want to come back to quickly, and then I have another question for you, but I just want to lift up something you said around, you know, the turnout around Asian Americans literally being able to utilize the absentee ballot voting. I don't think people really understand, you know, that there are people who are, that are living in fear, that are fearful, and that actually, that tool provides access because of safety issues and safety concerns. That's really real. And I want people to really understand that in the midst of the piece that we're not just talking about absentee just out of convenience, but people need that as a tool for access for a variety of reasons, and particularly those communities that feel most vulnerable need that tool. So I just want to thank you for lifting that up. I'll say, you know, there is a history of solidarity between the Asian American and the Black community in the South, you know, and our movements have been intersectional, you know, and they're showing up in this moment. And so I'm just wondering for you, how do you see some of the alignment and some of the work that's happening in Georgia along that line, those lines?
I think one story that is clear is when Alliance for Black Lives wanted to do a march around police brutality in Gwinnett, a lot of Asian Americans were nervous or didn't understand why. And so there was even a petition started by a group of Koreans, I'll just be honest, that had started up. So we had the organizers come and talk on Korean radio, Vietnamese radio, and Chinese radio, and we translated for them so that people in the community could hear firsthand why folks wanted to have these protests. And I think what happened in almost like a week's time, those same Korean Association folks actually changed their mind, stopped having the petition, decided to come to the march, actually as allies, give out water, masks, etc. And one individual spoke, and he was this older gentleman. He was in his 90s. He had been part of the uprising, or he had a store in LA. In the 90s, and he talked about and cried and talked about so much about how he couldn't be an ally then and how it and the things that he did and said during that time period, and that he urged people, young people, older people, and the community itself to heal and learn from his own lessons, and that now he can be the person that he always wanted to be, that he couldn't be then. And it was this moment where people were like, see the sort of like, this is what people were nervous about, and then this is a man who lived through it, and also talked about how he needed to forgive himself and also forgive others, and then also be like, this is the time to speak out. I was wrong. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that message was really powerful in that moment. Mm-hmm. And I think more and more conversations happening, and especially in areas, we all know, like Gwinnett, right? It's so different. I mean, it's like a really, right. When everyone kind of, when people come here, they sort of see Gwinnett as this like possibility, or they see the possibilities of it. And so I think it is that that change that we're hoping to see. And so more and more solidarity can happen between Asian, Black, and Brown.
You know, I think that's an excellent point you raise. You know, oftentimes I think, you know, with pain, you know, and trauma, it comes, it can either crush you or it can actually transform you. And so I think the opportunity, even what we're seeing and what we're experiencing, kind of the allyship and the coalition building in Georgia with groups like our own that are, have been working together and aligned, I think what we're seeing is in this moment that the attack on our humanity is actually forcing us to reclaim our humanity. That in fact, we're actually reclaiming our humanity. And so all of the marches I've been going to, all of the actions, it is beautiful. It's like the Rainbow Coalition. I've never seen that, you know, to the extent that I've been seeing now. And so oftentimes, even when people talk about the South, it's usually, it's like, it's just Black and white. That's not who makes up the South, right? That you have a beautiful diversity of people and growing communities. And the Asian American Pacific Islander community has been growing as well in Georgia, and is a significant part of the population in Georgia. And so I'm wondering from you, if, as it relates to democracy and the opportunities that exist, because we hear a lot about what's happening in the African American community and the white community and some of the tension, but we don't often hear, we hear much less about the AAPI community. And so from your perspective, what is the role of Asian Americans in creating this kind of new Georgia and this political landscape that I think ultimately is gonna transform this nation?
I think, our role is solidarity with Black and Brown communities always. It is our role and history of anti-Blackness and colorism that has worked to divide us and actually colonize us and forcibly put us in positions of where we felt like we needed to assimilate to white because we felt like that was the right way to go as immigrants. And then for Asian Americans, the future is, this is our opportunity, like don't go back. Right, don't go back in the shadows. Please say things, please stand up. This is the time. It's not a time of assimilation. That stuff didn't work for us, and as we can see. And that this is really the time, you know, many different scholars and activists always say, like, about when you're talking about liberation, it's tied together, right? It's beyond allyship. It has to be that you see your lives, or community intertwined with each other, and that liberation is collective. So my liberation is connected to other people's liberation and other communities of color. And so that is the important thing that I sort of
Ashe, Ashe. Thank you, Stephanie. You know, I have one last question for both you and Insei. And I don't know where you're hiding your cape, but I also know that you have a cape too. I just, you don't have yours right now, but I know you have a cape. I've seen yours as well. So what I want to do is I want to ask you both, you know, in the midst of the voter suppression that is happening, in the midst of this ongoing perpetual fight for voting rights that we're experiencing right now, I'm wondering from your perspective in this moment, what gives you hope? What are you hopeful for? What is, and I often ask this question, what is your radical reimagining of what Georgia can be or what this nation can be? I want to hear your vision. What gives you hope right now? And I'll start with you. I'll start with you, Insei.
just the leveling up of all of our institutions give me hope. I'm talking about churches and knitting circles with politics, right? That postcards and senior facilities and temples and fraternities and sororities, like it just seems to be a growing consciousness and a growing awareness and just an overall leveling up of people's analysis and their politics and like how they want to build with other organizations. I feel like that gives me hope. That's exciting because again, it doesn't rely on any sort of the heroics of an individual, that these are institutions that are being transformed in service of a better Georgia, in service of a Georgia that works for all of us. And I'm excited because I feel like it increases the likelihood that we will win. So that is very encouraging to me.
Yay.
Like your daddy's poker circle, his poker club, his poker, their Wednesday night poker, that they're talking about, you know, these municipal elections and voter suppression. And it's just really, really encouraging.
Thank you, Inse. Stephanie, what gives you hope, sister?
Young people always give me hope. You know, as all of us know, we were doing this work when no one cared. When no one was watching Georgia, when they made fun of us, you know, I mean, all those things, you know, and I think, you know, the young people have really been steadfast and now they're, you know, really leading, you know, sort of the work. And so I just see that as really the bright spot. And they're the ones that are pushing for abolition. They're the ones that are really pushing for that big North Star. So I'm always hopeful for that.
Absolutely. Well, the first thing I did right was the day I started to fight. Keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on. The thing that gives me hope is that I am on the battleground with women like the both of you. That the fact that literally I am convinced that we are going to literally change the world. I am convinced that we are creating and strengthening democracy and that in fact, we will have the democracy one day that we all desire. So thank you, Stephanie. Thank you, Inse, for your work. I enjoyed this discussion with you all in the conversation. Blessings, and I'll see y'all on the battleground.
Yes.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, LaTosha.
Thank you.
And Marjan Grace.
I just want to jump in and close and say you give us hope, knowing
yes.
that the political strategy of this nation is in the hands of women like you who are rewriting the blueprint. And, you know, we're in good hands. And every time we join in conversation, I feel so blessed to learn from you all. So we love you. We are grateful to you for your tireless work and your badassery in general. And we're just really grateful to have been able to tell a piece of your stories and she could be next.
Thank Marge you. Said it all.
Thank you everybody for
joining us. You all so much. Appreciate it.